welcome to the Jordan Center. A long time ago, probably 13 years ago, you know, I was writing my senior thesis at college on Futurism. And when I was, had already finished it and was, typing it up and creating a semblance of order, I was faced with this problem of quoting some of these texts, which were extremely visually innovative, impossible for, my very poor visual designs, graphic design skills to really embed in the regular text of my senior thesis. And, when I saw the project on which Daniel and Eugene have been working on, I really retroactively regretted not having it, because they are translating and bringing to life a text Russian futurists wrote, 101 years ago, that conveys, such impossible multimedia genres as, ferroconcrete poems and the kind of art that only, futurists could bring together. And so, just very briefly to introduce them and to introduce this event, and I find it very difficult to call it otherwise, because it's not a, you're not going to see an ordinary lecture, you're not going to see even an ordinary book launch, because there is no book, which is coming hopefully soon. But you're going to witness really the mastery you're going to see futurist art best conveyed into English, and rendered, into its original form. So, just very briefly about Daniel and Eugene. Eugene. Ostashevsky has a PhD in Slavic or comparative literature?
Comparative literature
from Stanford, and he's led this double life of, actually triple life of a scholar, a translator, and a poet. He's probably the chief force bringing into English the works of Russian Futurism, the Burliuk group, of which he's edited and translated an anthology, and a lot else, primarily through the Ugly Duckling Press. And as a poet, he's published 10 chapbooks and has won numerous awards. He, in his capacity as a translator, Daniel Mellis is a graphic artist who's published, who's helped bring into life books based on the law, on phenomenology of space, on visual, on built environment. And philosophy, he has his studies have been in mathematics until he I think experienced the transition into an MFA and the kind of design that I hope some of you are witnessing in this pilot copy. So I don't think I'll go on for much longer and leave the rest to you.
So I think I'm going to start, and I'm going to talk more about the typography and visual and materiality of the book, and then Eugene's going to talk about the language. So we're talking about Tango with Kyle, so hopefully you have a chance to page to those sort of digital snapshots of the project as it is right now. And so what is it? It's a key document in the history of Russian Futurism, modernist typography, visual poetry, and artist books. It was printed in Moscow in 1914 on brightly colored pentagonal wallpaper, and it combines poetry by Kamensky with three drawings by Vladimir and David Burliuk. So all the poems are extremely early examples of experimental typography and visual poetry, and are set in a riotous mix of typefaces. It's particularly known for its six sparrow concrete poems, which entirely dispense with a linear order of text and allow the reader to encounter it sort of spatially. So hopefully you've all seen this, but this is so the original and then the translation of some of them. So first I'm going to sort of take a deep dive into the just description of the book, and then come back out and talk about where it's from. So it's printed on the back of a really crummy wallpaper. This is my digital reconstruction of the full pattern. So it's kind of ugly floral wallpaper, but it was it's badly printed, but in five colors. So you can see, like, it was off register, like, so the green doesn't match up with the black, and at the very top of the screen you can see there's like a chunk missing out of the white, and the black is really runny. So it's just like really terrible wallpaper. But even still, I think the total cost for the edition of 300 copies would have been about 8 rubles, which is 8 times the cover price, but that's also about like a week's wage at the time for a laborer. And so it was mostly printed on the backs of this wallpaper, except for the cover. And it was bound by just stapling the sides and then gluing the covers on. So binding was really simple. So, and it was printed from metal and wood type, and the three illustrations were photo engravings. And no ornaments were used, except for there were 4 small crescents used to create the shape of the letter N in the last page. And so there's a lot of typographical variety in the book. And you can count it in different ways. So visually, it makes sense to count the number of typeface families and styles, which is 12 and 16. So here we see three styles, but 2 families. So accidents, grotesque, light, and Roman, and then the condensed, which is a different family. And then the serif faces were all one family. So there's a Roman, a bold, italic, and an inline. And then there's also these display or decorative faces. But, you know, metal type is a thing you hold in your hand, to quote Harry Carter. So it's not just enough to count how many styles, but you also want to know how many different fonts. So each style, each family, each style, each size. So, and in this accounting, the book uses 65 different fonts. So it's quite a bit of work for the printer. Although, if we only count the fonts of which 25 characters or more were used, it's only 38. So it's a little bit more manageable. So like, the ones on the bottom weren't used very much. Like this Skelet Italian, the typewriter, that's all the typewriter in the book, and that's all the Booker Medieval that was in the book. That was probably an accident. If I didn't mean to use that letter form. And these typefaces were all based on Roman originals. So they weren't originally designed for Cyrillic, but instead were designed for the Roman alphabet and then adapted. And they're almost all made by the Bertold Foundry, Type Foundry, which is one of the biggest in Germany and had a branch in St. Petersburg. And they were all designed in the late 1890s or early 1900s, except for 2 of them. So it certainly seems like the book is trying to be sort of Western and forward-thinking with its typography, although it can be hard to say because, you know, getting a printer to typeset the book might have been a pain in the, like, it'd be hard to find a printer who'd be willing to do that, so the typographic variety might also be just based on who they could convince to print it. So, it's unclear what other typefaces the printer had, because most books aren't cataloged by librarians by printer, so it's hard to find other things. So there's an earlier, slightly earlier book that's kind of the same book, an early edition we'll talk about later, that I know printed by the same printer. And there's also, so here's the accounting of the typefaces. So each style and each the sizes that it appears in there. So you can see the, like, these are sort of the workhorse faces because they're in so many different sizes, and these are kind of just the extra decorative ones. So this is the only other thing I know of printed by the same printer. And it, but it uses like almost all the same typefaces. There's not a lot. There's only three extra in there that weren't in Tango, and those are all just Roman versions of the original. One interesting thing is all these sort of Art Nouveau ornaments. And I think it's that, the not use of the those in Tango is deliberate, because the World of Art group and other sort of luxury periodicals that the Futurists were rejecting would have been using kind of that visual ornament. So I think that that's a clear choice. But another interesting thing is that there's not a use of a Scotch modern typeface, which is a very like typical 19th century face in which other Futurist publications used at the time. So, you know, maybe the printer didn't even have that and that wasn't a choice, but it'd be interesting to find other examples of the printer that had that, and then it might, you might be able to determine if it was a conscious choice. And the printer, I don't know much about the printer, so here's a map showing the school of art where Burliuk and Mayakovsky were expelled from, and then the bottom dot is the where the printer was. So it was close by to where they hung out. He doesn't appear in any of the, in the sort of the comprehensive book trade directory at the time, the Gazette and Emir. And also, I think it's a small shop, because if we count the number of faces at 68, that's enough to fill three cabinets of type, so like from here to Eugene. So that's not a lot of type for a print shop. So I imagine it was just kind of this crummy little job shop that they could convince to do this because they couldn't afford or convince someone who was like a bigger shop to do. Another sort of indication is the low standards of printing in the book. So here are some examples. So there's like bigger type that's damaged. So there's also in that typeface a lot of the O's are actually zeros. You can see in the projectoriat. I don't know Russian, so you have to excuse my pronunciation. The left one is the O, and then right is the zero. So that was probably because they ran out of zeros or O's and had to use the zero, or maybe they just didn't distribute them well and they were just in the O box when they were setting the type. So, and then there's also a lot of spacing workup. So with metal type, you also have to put the spaces in as a piece of metal, and if they rise to the level of the printing surface, they'll print. And so we can see here five examples of that in the book. So that's just, that to me tells me the printer wasn't doing a very good job or didn't care. But I think even though it was like maybe this crummy little printer, it would have been expensive to pay for the composition because it was very complicated typesetting. So, and I think the strongest evidence for that is actually this book, Naked Among the Clad, which reproduces all six of the pharaoh concrete poems, the spatial poems that are in Tango. And then it also has poems by this guy, Andrei Kratsov, a doctor who they met, the Futurists met on their tour of the provinces. And so, and there's a letter or a memoir of someone who met Kamensky, and Kamensky gave him this book, but ripped out Kratsov's poems and said they were terrible. So I feel like they got him to, they're like, hey, why don't you publish this book with us and pay for the printing? And then they said to the printer, don't put the type away, we'll use it later on the real book. So I think that, because they came out maybe within a couple weeks of each other, so it's hard to imagine that they weren't exploiting Kravtsov. So if we pull back from this look at the book, I want to answer the question of where it came from. You know, where did this sort of radical thing come from? So the most obvious context is the Russian Futurism. So it was mostly literary, but also visual movement. The main contributors included Klebnikov, Krashenik, Burliuk, Mayakovsky, and Ilya Zdanovich. And artists included Goncharova, Larionov, Malevich, and Rosanova. And they rejected their recent literary past and courted controversy. The manifesto, a slap in the face of public taste, said that Pushkin was as incomprehensible as hieroglyphics, and that he, as well as Dostoevsky and the Russian symbolists, should be tossed overboard the steamboat of modernity. And this rejection carried through the physical form of their books. So in contrast to the luxurious publications of the Russian symbolists, the World of Art Group and other artistic and literary magazines with high production value. So here's a Ivan Bilibin opera program. And you, I think it's interesting to note that sort of very Slavic, pre-Petrine letter forms that Tango is consciously, I think, moving away from. Which is interesting because other futurists were into kind of this, like, looking into the history of Russia for inspiration. But so they made these books like A Trap for Judges, which is also printed on wallpaper. So the Tango and Naked Among the Clad didn't initiate that. This is a slap in the face of public taste, which is printed on burlap and really crummy paper. There's also these lithograph books, mostly in the which was Krashenik involved, and so that's handwritten and then transferred and printed by lithography, and the images could also be put in at the same time. And there's a lot of paper collage, hand coloring, rubber stamps, and the hectograph process, which was a kind of office duplicating process. So it's they were very crude and intentionally so. I think like modern day zines are an interesting contemporary counterpoint. So, and but it's but also despite their name, the futurists were concerned with like a primitivism, neo-Slavicism, and linguistic experimentation, and so, and Kamensky wrote a anti-urban novel, Zemlyanka, Earth Hut, whose main character is an alter ego of himself who flees to the country after an unhappy love affair and finds redemption in marriage and peasant life. So where did the urban orientation of Tango come from? There's poems on flying, telephones, the movies, cabarets, modern art, and roller skating. So one source is his detour into flying. So he earned a pilot's license and gave it up, although when he crashed into a swamp, he almost died. I think another influence is Mayakovsky, whose poetry was sort of very urbanist. And then also Marinetti is a clear source. And the timing of the publication, The Naked Among the Clad, came out right when Marinetti was in Russia, and Tango shortly thereafter. So I think it's really tempting to see that as a response to Marinetti's visit. And so Marinetti not only did he extol the beauty of modern technology and modern life, but also in the, he called for a revolution of the printed word. For example, in the Technical Manifesto of Futurist Literature, he proposed that we have to destroy syntax, to scatter nouns at random, even as they come to mind. We have to get rid of adjectives so that the unadorned noun retains its essential color. Abolish punctuation as well, to emphasize particular shifts and indicate the direction we'll make use of mathematical signs. Plus, minus, times, ratio, equals, greater than, less than. There's some examples in the Constantinople poem with the plus sign being used. And in his manifesto, Destruction of Syntax, Untrammeled Imagination, Words and Freedom, he says, my revolution is directed against the so-called typographic harmony of the page, which contradicts the ebb and flow, the leaps and bounds of style that surge over the page. We shall therefore use three or four different colors of ink on a single page, and should we think it necessary, as many 20 typographical characters. So, but I think Eugene's going to show some more of Marinetti's work, but before 1914, early 1914, when Tango with Cows came out, Marinetti's work didn't really take as advantage of the space of the page as Kamensky, and his texts are almost inevitably linear. They might be experimental typography, but they're still linear. And so that might have been because of his great gifts as an orator. He might have been reluctant to publish things that he couldn't perform, because obviously oration is linear. And so other points of origin are Mallarmé's Un Coup de Dé, which might have influenced Marinetti. I'm not sure if Kamensky ever saw this, and the prose of the Trans-Siberian Railway. But both of those are also linear. So Kamensky really, I think, pioneers this spatial poem where there's no order at all. Although there's a, closer to home, there's a so-called Reyes poetry in the Donkey's Tale and Target, and the essay and perhaps the poetry is by Ilya Zadanovich. And so that sort of begins to explore the page as a space, but they're kind of not that complicated. And but in addition to these literary and artistic sources, I think it's also important to look to advertising. And that often anticipates and inspires experimentation in avant-garde. And they were certainly interested in the visual appearance of the city as a poetic space. So Mayakovsky's poem, To Signs, he exhorts the reader to read iron books. And Kamensky refers to electric billboards as hundreds of ferroconcrete poems in dresses from the fabric of x-rays in the poem From Hieroglyphs to A. He also published the Constantinople poem as a broadside, and you're going to see the pluses at the bottom if you have good eyes, on sateen. And the text states it's for walls and fences, so presumably they put these up as broadsides over time. And also in the roller rink poem, there's this, which is basically a kind of torn advertisement for cigarettes. And if we look at contemporary outdoor advertising, so here are some examples, and then here are a couple of pre-revolutionary Russian circus posters, we can see a similar division of the page and the use of a lot of different typefaces. And also it's interesting with the circus posters, it's hard to tell, but a lot of the same typefaces on the posters were also used in Tango. So clearly they were being used in the context of advertising. And also the printed matter. So this is from Cinema Magazine. So again, the similar kind of division of space. And then, but I think this in turn is influenced from the artistic printing movement of the 1880s. So this was something developed mostly in America and Western Europe, and it's a response to the lithography. So it was an attempt by letterpress printing to compete with lithography, which was much more, and much more freedom because it was just drawing. Whereas letterpress, you have, you know, individual pieces of metal that you have to assemble into a page. So here's some couple of examples of that. And clearly that must have ended Russia, and a couple of the, they would have exchanges where people would send in their best work, and a couple of them came from like the state printing office in the 1880s. So I think that typography comes from the artistic printing. And I think there's some irony here because for ferroconcrete poems, it would have been easier and cheaper to set to do lithography. And this is an example of that from 1917 of Kamensky using lithography in his ferroconcrete poems. But I think using lithography at that time was actually something really only Krushenik did, and that all the other books that the Futurists published were letterpress, all but one. And also using metal type, as I've said, let it, the visual orientation become closely with, tied with advertising, with the urban space, with Western Europe. So I think lithography, even if it might have been easier, wouldn't let the book have those associations. But, and so now, so we're doing this English translation, so I'm going to talk about that now. And so I'm working, so I've recreated the wallpaper So I wanted to, you know, recreate the materiality of the original. So I wanted to really remake the wallpaper to match the original. So this is, the color is different because this is an earlier draft. I just didn't have an image. But this is a custom-made Japanese paper, and it's 5-color silkscreen. And the original would have been printed with relief rollers, but the way the ink sits on the page with contemporary silkscreen is very similar to the original. So that's why I chose that. And also it's just logistically much more practicable to do it that way. And I'm also going to, so it's difficult to recreate the bad printing in the exact same way. So a lot of the dropouts and bad register I was able to recreate, but the runniness of the black ink was something that just couldn't be done in that process. So it's kind of funny to try to print something badly in the same way. Printing something well, again, is not hard, but printing something bad is actually tricky. And then for the typography, I wanted to recreate everything as closely as possible. I didn't want to just use a typeface that looked kind of similar. So I actually, using a digital facsimile, I sorted every single character in the book by size and style. So this is just one, this is all just the sans serif. So for every style that I showed earlier, it's all sorted into size. And that, it's let me get a sense of, you know, how the book was made as well. And then the next step was to find specimen books that had that type in it. So I didn't want to have to guess if I needed a Q, what a Q would be from the Cyrillic, but I could find specimen books with that corresponding alphabet. And then I either drew, modified, or found digital typefaces that matched. And so there's a lot of finicky work that went into this. That's maybe why it's been taking so long. So like this typeface, Herald Condensed, was used in 4 sizes. And so with metal type, often each size was designed differently. So for this, I designed the biggest size and the smallest size differently and then interpolated them to get different optical sizes for the for the printing. So that's something that digital typography hasn't really caught up with the technology of metal, is that it's all one size, it's just scaled, but you might want a different design for very small type or for a very big type. So I'm going to print the book letterpress using photopolymer plates output from the computer file, and that will let me really recapture the bad printing of the original and the characteristic qualities of letterpress, especially when there's lightly printed type, and so that, you know, it won't look just kind of like the digital ones, like just super slick and digital. It'll actually feel materiality-wise like the original. So the binding is easy because it's just stapling. So that gives you a sense. I think we passed around some of this. This is the actual wallpaper we're going to use. And then I think you can, we passed around some examples of what the typography is going to look like. So I think that's basically my talk.
Has everybody seen the laser printed version? Yeah. Should we take a break of 5 minutes so that everybody looks at the version?
Sure.
Why don't we take a quick break and I'll queue up and
can I ask you a question about that? What's the material that the wallpaper is made of?
So it's printed on a really thin, even thinner than this paper. It's just a yellow paper, and it has like kind of speckles in it too.
Okay. It's just like a wood pulp, or is it?
Yeah. I imagine it's just. I mean, it really is just really crummy wallpaper, I think. I emailed with a Russian wallpaper, the Contemporary Russian Wallpaper Institute, and they sent me images of like a wallpaper sample book from around the time, and you know, it was like crummier than the crummiest one in the book. I mean, maybe the one in the book, the sample in the book, they print really well for their sample book, and then the printing is really bad otherwise. But it was definitely kind of a low end. But it's still, you know, if you're printing 300 copies, that really adds up.
Yeah.
So the other futurist publications around the time they would do like 500, 750, 1,000 copies, and this is relatively small. So I think part of the problem is just like the upfront cost of the wallpaper.
Any reason why they used wallpaper versus, I mean, it was just cheap paper that they found, or something like it was an ideological choice? Or?
I think, you know, it's like shocking, and it's kind of vulgar, and it's also, color printing is really expensive, so if they wanted to print this wallpaper, it would have been really expensive to like custom print anything, so having it be off the shelf,
right.
I think is also like, much cheaper option.
Did you maybe research why did they cut? Why did they make this format?
There's not really anything that explains why they did that. I mean, he called the poems like pharaoh concrete, so maybe it's sort of like a form for casting. But it's not really clear why. I don't know.
I'm gonna go with that.
I mean, I have
something between the hypothesis and the theory. There's enough evidence to pull it.
So does anyone have questions about the production?
Did you guys see the book? Yeah?
Okay. I just want everybody to take a look at it. Because I'm going to be talking about the language of the text and talking about it as a piece of poetry, of visual poetry. One of the things that got me really interested in the Tango is a number of the poetic techniques that Kamensky is using, of the way in which, actually I need to sit like this, of the way that he plays with words. And I'm going to talk about different kinds of wordplay, and also I'm going to talk about parallels in the painting of the time, because I think this is a text that is quite closely connected to the use of words in cubist, futurist, avant-garde painting, and in general working on this project made me realize that, the way scholars talk about Russian futurist poetry and the kind of the poetics of the poetry really divorces it from what I think is the extremely closely connected area of the usage of words in painting, right? And in particular, more and more working on this, do I become convinced that Zang in a way originates in painting rather than anywhere else. So just as Kamensky's context that you've heard about in terms of the visuality of poetry at the time, February 1913, already starting from, I think, November, December 1912, Leonov and Gonchirova are working with Kruchonich on these little chapbooks that they make first with Kruchonich and Khrebnikov, then just with Kruchonich. Pomada, which is, I forget, number five, number four in the series, is the first one in which Zaum, in which abstract poetry appears. It's a lithograph. it's handwritten by Larionov, and I will get back to things written by Larionov a bit later. But as you can see, this is primitivist. It's extremely different from what Kamensky is doing in Tango, at least by the looks of it. So Tragedia of Vladimir Mayakovsky, right, the tragedy that was staged in early December 1913, was published at exactly the same time as Tango by the same group. It was probably Burliuk who was supervising the production of that book. And you can see it looks beautiful, but the use of different typefaces is decorative in the sense that you can read this poem, and those of you that have read this poem or play, however you want to describe it, in Russian, generally you read it in a normal typeface, in normal layout, and you could still read it. You can't do that with Tango, right? With ferrocarbide poems, you can't print them in a different way. They don't make sense, okay? So this is kind of, it looks nice, but it's not as interesting. Okay, now at the same time, and what is really interesting, that at exactly the same time, Marinetti is working on Zang Tumb Tumb, which is his book of words and freedom, of Parole et Libertà, about the siege of Edirne in the Turkish-Bulgarian War. Zang Tumb Tumb is officially released in March. Marinetti is in Russia by European calendar between February 8th and March 2nd. When he arrives, January 26th, by the Russian Julian calendar, February 8th by the European calendar, in an interview to a Russian paper, he says that he doesn't have any copies with him as yet. Zang Tumb Tumb is what he reads during his evenings in Moscow and Petersburg. He recites it. There are all sorts of descriptions of, you know, all the funky noises that he makes. He imitates a machine gun. He imitates cannons. He imitates airplanes. It's a very impressive. It's sound. Okay? The book, at least in the beginning, is not there. Then if you look at memoirs, Lifshitz claims that about 10 days after Marinetti's arrival, that Marinetti gives him a copy. And I'm like, do they have FedEx? I mean, how does... So if the printer sends him an advance copy, can it reach him in that time? And I have no idea. But if you look at Roman Jakobson's, you know.
Did he have mock copy like you have now?
You know, I thought of that as well, maybe. But the copy that I gave Lifshitz is a regular copy. Mm-hmm. I think what might be more likely, either somehow it reached him, but we have no record of it reaching him, or Lifshitz, you know, is writing his memoirs. It comes out in 1930. So it's about 15 years later that he's writing it. Jakobson, remembering things much, much later, but in great detail also, says that the copy that Marinetti gave him, Marinetti mailed to him after he got home. And the inscription that Lifshitz describes as kind of an inscription made solely for him, I found a version of it in Berlin made to a German writer. So clearly it's, you know, Marinetti was using the same, pretty much the same form of signature. So it's really not clear. But as I will show later, it doesn't really matter. The words and freedom appear in La Cerba. The first issue in which they appear is December 1913. As you can see, this is super, I mean, this is very linear. Yeah, this is not like Kamensky at all. January 1st, so mid-December by the Russian calendar, you know, it's still, Marinetti is still publishing stuff in that chair, but it looks like this. However, Francesco Cangiulo on January 1st publishes a work called The Smokers, where he actually is thinking at least much more in terms of the page, as you can see here. Now, Marinetti certainly would have had copies of Lachebo with him when he came to Russia. And in fact, Larionov, who, according to Jakobson's memoirs, got drunk several times with Marinetti during Marinetti's visit. Larionov has a whole, he has all the copies of La Cerba, starting from this one. It's in London, I haven't been able to look whether there's an inscription, but it might be that Marinetti basically kind of gave him a bunch of copies when he arrived. And this is what Marinetti is doing on February 15th in La Cerba. He probably would have had advanced copies of this, because by Russian calendar, this is due out 6 days after Marinetti arrived. So he probably would have had advanced copies. And just as a side note, Apollinaire is responding to the Decagon. He's responding to it in June in Paris with the first of the calligrammes, right? So Apollinaire's calligrammes start as a response to Marinetti. Okay, but if you look at dates for the release of The Naked Among the Clad by Kamensky and Kravtsov, it's registered on February 19th by Russian calendar. So basically, it officially comes out, which means that they probably would have had copies about a week to 2 weeks to maybe even 3 weeks beforehand. A week after Kamensky could have, the only time that he could have met Marinetti, on the 12th of February. It's by the same printer as Tango. It includes all the six ferroconcrete poems in the same composition. So, I mean, you know, Kamensky, who has a history of like funny money dealings, having to do with his wife and airplanes, clearly did something similar here. Basically, he talked Kravtsov into publishing a book with him, you know, saying good. Kravtsov is one of the fans that showed up at the reading, I think, in Kharkov in the middle of December. He's working with him. And then I started looking at newspapers, and that allowed me to date a number of the poems. For example, the circus poem coincides pretty much exactly to the program for the Nikitin Circus for the first 2 weeks in January. After January 17th, the clown Durov, that some of you might have heard of, is performing at the Nikitin Circus, so he surely would have been in this poem. Before January 1st, it's a totally different program. The pantomime Camorra, the claws of the black hand, was actually designed for the 40th anniversary of the Nikitin Circus, which happened like December 31st or something. So it gives us a pretty exact date. Yeah. In any case, we also know that January 16th, Kamensky is already in Odessa. So he must have done it in those days. And then I found the film that at least the key part of Kamensky's poem called Cinematograph talks about. It's possible that the film exists because the other day I found that it was also available in English under a different title, so I need to search for it under the title of When Fire Rages. But generally, in Russian, it's called Transatlantic Jupiter. It's a French film called Danse Héroïque. In English, it's called The Mid-Atlantic, or as I found out, When Fire Rages. And here's the plot of it. It's curious. It's shown all over the world, all the way to New Zealand. In Russia, it's shown first. There's something weird about the way that it's shown in Russia, because there are ads in the papers, but it's never shown in the official registrar of films shown in movie magazines. The only thing that I found was kind of a review of it, ads review, and something saying, something from January 11th saying that it passed to great acclaim in Moscow theaters. But when you look at the actual program, it's not in the program. So there's something kind of fishy about it. Maybe it's like a pre-release. Maybe they were testing it out, I don't know, on Russian audiences. But it's pretty much, it's definitely this film. I mean, I looked at all the other possible films that have to do with ships. It's gotta be this one. Probably in part inspired by the Titanic. The plot is basically a fire breaks out on a ship where there's a young male protagonist who's in love with a dancer, but he's engaged to be married to somebody else. And there's, you know, the dancer wants to distract the crowd so that there's no panic during the fire, and dances even though she knows there's a fire. I mean, it's, and it has a typical sad Russian ending where she renounces the young man and his future marriage and drives off in an automobile. There were some of the other poems could also be dated. Vizov, which is not like Cinematograph, it's not a frame, it's not a picture poem, but it's kind of a regular poem. Is read on November 11th. A Tango with Cows, the title poem, is read in January. And you already saw the Constantinople broadside on Satin. So basically, this allows us to date the poems in the whole book certainly before Marinetti's visit, and pretty much before Kamensky's being able to see even any issue of La Cherva with even interesting, anything remotely interesting, okay? He certainly heard about Marinetti's manifesto. Opening any journal, any anthology by the Cuba Futurists that winter, you can immediately see that they all read the destruction of syntax, because they're all using mathematical operators. I mean, they're all using things that are from them, right? But in fact, Marinetti's manifesto, in the part that calls for free liberated typography, doesn't say anything particularly exciting. It says, I'm quoting it in French because they would have read it in French, but you know, sensations you put in italics, you know, when bombs explode, you put it in boldface. It's not very inventive. Okay, so painting. Larionov, I did not look very systematically at Malevich, because Larionov struck me as kind of being more, possibly more productive, but I will at some point look at Malevich much more systematically, trying to do it by months. So Larionov starts with words in his paintings in around 1910, 1911, when he is drafted, or maybe volunteers, I'm not sure, but anyway, he's an officer in the barracks, and he has a whole series of soldier paintings, which are primitivist, and they're lovely. And he gets really interested in graffiti. But he gets interested in graffiti in kind of a, it's a way, if you like, it's very close to Kruchonok, okay? It's scatological, it's really provocative. If you look carefully at what the graffiti says in the back, it says srok slujbe, which is term of service, and then it says последний раз sr, which is, it might be I'm going to the toilet for the last time. It's really not clear because it's cut off, right? But srok, like the sr acquires this meaning from being associated with, I mean, this is something that is tremendously crude for 1911, right? But it's also, I mean, the anal scatological theme, it's very much what Kruchonov picks up later. And this way of thinking of associating by sound is also very typical of kind of that faction of Russian futurism, even though this is 1911. And I mean, he has other, this is not an accident. Other paintings from that series do something very similar. Okay, then when the French start doing, start stenciling letters as part, initially it starts with analytical cubism, as you can see with Braque, but it pretty much ends analytic cubism, right? Braque, the Portuguese, the first painting in which stenciled letters appear, I mean, this is Grand Bal, this is Oko, maybe Chocolat. Yeah, the words are cut. In theory, the words float on the surface of the painting, so they don't represent anything. Here, you know, people that study Braque say, well, maybe this is still, he's thinking of it still as like a shop window or something. In Larionov, who picks this up in 1913, you immediately see the kind of wordplay that you don't get in Braque. Ba-ul-da, he had a fight with Tatlin. So he's making a portrait of Tatlin at the age of 28. And he writes, like doofus, yeah? And, but when you look at it, you know, it takes a while to figure out that it says balda. It would have been funnier if it said balda, rather than ba-ul-da, but whatever. You can't have everything. Okay, so Shukin, the collector, one of the two main collectors, the collector whose house all the painters went to on Sundays, and whose purchase advisor Larionov was at some point, at the end of 1913, buys a Picasso with words, and once again, these are, the words are cut. So the agran over there is probably, might be mazagran, which is basically iced coffee in the Algerian style, or some people say Portuguese style. I don't know why it's both Algerian and Portuguese, whatever. But it could be Rue Lagrange. It's not clear what it says on the bottom, whether it says café or cliché or whatever. The point is you obfuscate, as Picasso so often does. You cut letters in such a way that they can read this way or they can read that way, which is precisely what we're going to see Kamensky doing. I don't think that Kamensky remarks this painting when he goes to Shukin's mansion. At least it doesn't appear in the poem. You can basically make a list of all the paintings that he saw from this poem, because that's what this poem really is. But this purchase, which happens in the end of 1912, is historically very important because it's immediately shown to the Larionov group and other people, and they immediately start stenciling words everywhere in their paintings. Another thing that happens in France that's also, Kamensky certainly did not see this, but it's similar, at least in spirit, that's playing around with advertising, right? What Picasso does with the way that he cuts words in newspapers, transforming them into different words. Okay. So here you have trousseau, which becomes trou, right? Or un coup de théâtre becomes un coup de thé. Okay, so Larionov clearly gets excited by the possibilities. And in a book of another Russian futurist, he publishes, if it said 3 rubles, it would be 3 rubla. But what he's doing is 3 R and then bla, which is a cutoff word for whore. So he's using the word in two, he's using the 3 letters in two completely possible ways. It's very funny also in a way, in the way that kind of Larionov's preoccupations with low life. It's funny. Gonchirova, who's a bit more genteel, does a laundromat, right? Prachichna, I don't know what board is. Both of these paintings? No, this painting is at the Tate, and I forget where this one is. BS is probably Bele Stirka whitewash. But when she does Lady with a Hat, 3N5TE row, I have no idea what that is. Except, if you look at this, yeah, we all see this? This kind of weird thing in red. It's not just any lady in a hat. It's a futurist lady in a hat. So this is the Larionov group, both the Larionov group and the Cubo futurists start painting their faces in order to advertise performances shows. I mean exhibits. So in December of 1913, Zdanevich and Larionov published a manifesto on face painting, and you can see that this sign, you know, it's the same kind of incomprehensible sign that appears. So it's a futurist lady with a hat. And here is a painter from the Larionov circle named Maurice Fabry, who the more you look into that circle, there's not a lot of stuff written about it as a circle. They're really, really interesting. They're super interesting. They might be actually more interesting and kind of more hardcore than the much more famous Mayakovsky and everybody else. Okay, because Fabry, for example, apparently, okay, so Zdanevich during the war works as a journalist, but kind of like an anti-colonial journalist covering the Russian army in the Turkish front, writing about various minorities, the way that they're abused by both armies, okay? Fabry, I mean, this is totally has nothing to do with Tango with cows, but it's very interesting. Fabry apparently, at least according to stuff that was published very recently, joins the Ottoman army and fights against the Russians on the Ottoman side. And that's really all I know about him. I don't know a single one of his paintings. But they're a really interesting group. And clearly this kind of interest in Russia as Asia and in Eastern art that the Leonov group declares in late 1913, early 1914, in a way despite Marinetti, but even they start declaring it before. So for example, when the Trans-Siberian Railroad in December 1913, when a copy of the Delaunay Sankar book is shown to Shukin by a friend of Sonia Delaunay, and she suggests that Shukin buy it, Leonov is present at this meeting as like the main purchasing advisor. And Leonov says, or Shukin says, one of them says, that, you know, right now we don't buy anything Western anymore, with a possible exception of Picasso. We're only interested in Eastern art. So which of them says it, it's not clear, but I saw the letter in Paris. Okay, so to get to Kamensky. So you see all these features in the poems. Numbers, you see telephone numbers, time, I think license plates. I don't know what these are. These might also be license plates. Prices, ticket, 20 kopecks, bath ticket. Entrance, 1 ruble. Exit, 1,000 rubles. Right, this is for an after hours Turkish bar in Moscow. These by different people have been interpreted as either tickets for the cabaret zone or tickets for women in the cabaret zone. So not tickets, and prices. Weights, right, 4 stone, 9 pounds. And probably flight records, 6,175 meters. I don't know. Sounds like a flight record if it's Kamensky.
And also a date.
Oh yeah, yeah, date. I read on the 27th. Yeah, or somebody read on the 27th. Yeah. So numbers appearing basically as signs of modernity, signs of quantification. Letters, sights and sounds. Sights, because if we look at just the Constantinople, yeah, right, you see this E with, like, you see the ikratka, right, in a poem that talks about crescents. So it seems to be the visual form, right? And talks about Hagia Sophia, with, you know, which looks a bit like this, which Janacek, I think, talks about that. But also sounds, right? You have Enverbeini, Bey, Golubey, right? So on both the visual, right, and the oral dimension, or, I mean, all these little, these O's and these zeros, that's how
those words. I think those are zeros.
Zeros, right? Which, it's from the skating ring, it's a roller skating ring, and it's supposed to, you know, it's the roller skates, but also the way it glistens, and also the way the sounds work. Льются лики, тлики, ролики, кролики, королики, журчей, журчани, стоники, слепли. Right, so, again, it's very futurist in the Italian sense because it's kind of multi-dimensional visual. It's a visual work that's also a work about sound, right? But you know, I don't know when the Italians start doing this, but the manifesto, Carrà's manifesto, is later.
So which year is this?
Which year is this?
Yes.
This is officially registered on March 27th, 1914. So it means that it's probably out I don't know, first week of March. So, shortly after Marinetti leaves. Anyway, all sorts of letters that are either images or puns, like douche, e. It took me a really long time to figure out that it's douche, douche, right? Which is a shower of the soul. Then there's advertiser. Yeah, I mean, the most obvious thing is the La Ferme cigarettes. For some reason, stupidly, as I was preparing this, I cut out number 66666. But in fact, the brand is La Ferme number 6. La Ferme is the big company, and they have a number of brands. Raja, Atama, these are all cigarettes. There's work with branding, with names of establishments, the skating ring, the cabaret, Maxim's, which opened, I think, in 1913 and was the kind of big tango place. And they also had like a Turkish after-hours bar. And as I was telling Daniel earlier, all the Turkish people were actually French, or at least the main Turkish people, the main dancers, and the circus poster. And the circus poster, we argued about this, reproduces typos. It's the only page that has typos is the circus page. And if you look at really cheap printing from that time, it's full of typos. So that was my
And they do change something slightly from the first printing to the second printing. So they would have been, if there was really a typo, they could have corrected.
Yeah, this would have, you know, the correcting moles to mops would have been very easy. But they don't do that. There is, especially in Constantinople, there's a lot of kind of borderline sound work with the sounds of foreign language. Constantinople is a lot about the way that Turkish sounds. There's a phrase in Turkish that's in like really bad Turkish. And then there is what Kamensky claims are Turkish women's names. That are mostly Persian. And then his interpretation of a Turkish fisherman's song, which doesn't sound anything like any possible Turkish fisherman's song. He claims he went to Constantinople twice in his memoirs around the year 1905, I think once in 1904 and once in 1906 or something. His early memoirs are completely untrustworthy. Then there's something, the term that they used is razlom, which is the breaking of something open. It's cutting words, doing palindromes, this is very cool, telescoping. Fies. Key, right, fezes, ko, fear, coffee, fierski, right, so the kind of the words turn into one another. Picasso noi, right, Picasso with me. Putting things in. And then the most exciting thing is a special kind of rhyme that Kamensky develops. It's a rhyme that also appears in his other work, but it appears primarily here. And it's a kind of echo rhyme. In English, the most famous usage of it is George Herbert. But this is clearly independent of George Herbert. And it's much more complicated than echo rhyme tends to be. There are examples of echo rhyme in Russian Baroque stuff in the 17th century also. You have amazing things like matrosy, trosy, osy in Constantinople, which gives you, it means sailors, iron cables, and wasps. And I mean, the whole, you know, it gives you a landscape. That's the best one. Young ladies, little ears, девушки, ушки. There's a lot. These were very hard to translate. And then all sorts of loose sound structures. Мане нет, you know, Моне, who's spelled with a T in French. Нет тень драпри при мне. The shadow of the drapery has remained with me. A line about syphilis. Lisse golos luessa, right? Luessa is it's a slang for syphilis, which in English is loose or lose. So it's a lot. Okay, so, and the last couple of slides are about the book as an object, which is also tremendously avant-garde. I do think that Tango with Cows is, how can I say this? Even the color of it is important, and the name is important. And both the color of the yellow that predominates in the book, as well as the other colors, but the yellow first and this kind of yellow first and foremost. And the name Tango, they're both self-branded, or rather branding of Cubo Futurism, in particular of the tour that Kamensky was on intermittently between December and March 27th of 1913-1914 with Mayakovsky, with Burliuk. Kamensky is also pretty much the tour manager. And they go all over all the provincial towns of Russia, and they put up posters like this. This is the Kiev poster for January 28th, where you can see the lettering of different sizes. And apparently, this poster was originally yellow. At least Kamensky's memoirs, not the first edition, but the 1940 edition. If you just go through the memoirs looking for the word yellow or orange-like, apelsinovy, I mean, all the key futurist things are described as being of that color. So it's the poster. It's obviously Mayakovsky's jacket. And Mayakovsky must have owned several of these jackets because the descriptions do not match. There's a set of descriptions that talk about like a yellow jacket with black stripes, yellow-orange with black stripes, and then there's a whole bunch where it's just yellow. And these are different journalists writing in different papers, different memoirs, so it, you know, has to be different. And then finally, when in the one sentence that in his memoirs where he talks about the book coming out, you know, he uses the same word orange as is used elsewhere to describe Mayakovsky's clothes. I mean, everywhere. Yeah.
Do you have an answer why yellow?
Because it's just the most provocative color. Mayakovsky sometimes wore red, like at the debate with Marinetti, he wore red.
Is it maybe connected with victory over Zang?
I mean, maybe, but it he starts wearing it before victory over the sun. Mm-hmm. So if it's connected to victory over this, that's a really good question. If it's connected to victory over the sun, it certainly wasn't connected to in the very. I think that no, the code dates from before victory.
You mean the staging?
Yeah, which is in December, right? It's the Russian play, which is staged in December. I'm pretty sure that he wears the blouse already. You can't tell because the photos are black and white, right? So it's hard to tell. Okay, so then the fact that wallpaper is used, you know, there are three Russian futurist books that are done on the reverse side of wallpaper. The Naked and the Clad and the Tango are two from 1914. And the first anthology, 1910, which is probably put together by Kamensky primarily, certainly put together with Kamensky. Kamensky opens it. And it's supposed to be the first book of Russian Futurism. It's done on the reverse side of wallpaper. If you look at Picasso's collages, which Kamensky could not have seen live, maybe he saw a reproduction somewhere, stuff that Picasso was doing in 1912, 1913, huge amount of wallpaper, so that might have kind of helped, if he saw it, which is it. And finally, Tango. Okay, the Tango craze. Hits Paris in the spring and summer of 1913. It hits Russia around November, December. January, February, you look at popular magazines, they're all tango. That's what they're about. Yeah, constantly. Here's an issue of Satyricon from February 13th. And there's a rumor. There's a rumor that street signs are going to be taken down in favor of pure lettering, and both the merchant and the futurist are bewailing this fact. Then here's an art, you know, kind of a funny. It's not very funny. Article on the tango, and as usual, there's a guy who gets carried away with dancing the tango and winds up dancing with his mother-in-law. I mean, there's always the mother-in-law at the end. This was kind of, the mother-in-law was the epitome of Russian humor in 1913. But it ends with, Diaghilev is taking me to dance in Rome before the Pope. Hooray, tango! Tango Naranto, tangonistic tangoing, go no to trr, long live futurism. So the association of tango with futurism, you know, two kind of imports. Marinetti, weirdly enough, delivers a manifesto. In January called Down with Tango, which he also reads in Russia, but Russian futurists are associated with the tango. And especially the Lirionov Circle, who they shoot a film starring Goncharova called Drama in Cabaret 1913, in Cabaret number 13, in Futurist Cabaret 19. Number 13. And with Leonov and Goncharova participating, and all, the entire Futurist Society, more than 130 people that dance the tango. The film has not survived. You know, if you look to see what the Futurists are doing in those days, apart from performances, apart from discussions whether futurists are or not schizophrenic, there are also discussions of the tango. So when Mayakovsky and Burliuk interrupt their tour to kind of have it out with Marinetti, the next day they're taking part in a panel about the tango, right? You know, what can they possibly know about the tango? Do you know what I mean? They're not professional dancers. But as futurists, they're felt to be, you know, qualified to discuss tango with this guy, Bonch Tomaszewski, who in 1914 publishes a whole book about the tango as the angular, discontinuous dance of modernity that is in the rhythm of factories and machinery. And finally, the color yellow. Zdanievich in April delivers a talk on tango, which he ends by citing an anecdote that some merchant who had all this old cloth called the color tango, and the cloth was bought out immediately. So it's a very interesting book. It's a book that really is deeply embedded in the culture and that is tremendously, tremendously, tremendously avant-garde. Italian futurists will start making book objects in the 1920s in the second wave, right? And this is pretty much already there. Okay, so that's it. Yeah.
You owe us, I think, why it is cut that way, your theory, I think.
I forgot. Let's have a picture of... I need a picture of any one of the pages. If you look at any... Russian version of analytical cubism, that's how it's cut. These are the black lines, they're planes. Yeah? So if you look, let me see if... Okay, there's something going on with... Okay, but just if you look at the way that space is divided in these paintings, it's constantly these lines. And if you look at the way that they paint the faces, they're also dividing the sign into planes, mm-hmm. using these black lines.
And the lines are, I think, explain why it's called ferroconcrete, because they're like the rebar in the concrete, and also structurally for the printers, it would have been easier to divide up the page. So they might have put like pieces of leading, like strips of metal to divide the page to make it easier to set. And so you could have easily, so they're fulfilling this kind of division already. And so printing them is kind of a natural thing to do.
And the other thing that's interesting about the ferroconcrete is I just took out from the library a book on the Trans-Siberian Railroad on the Sangha. And if you look at the correspondence around the prose of Trans-Siberian, Sangha, he has this tic. He keeps saying that simultaneity, right? And simultaneity is kind of, you know, this is a simultaneous poem, right? In that you don't read it linearly, but, you know, it's all together. When Zang talks about simultaneity, what he's talking about is this combination of picture and text, right? That they work together and not separately. When Zang is talking about simultaneity, what he also means is a color theory. That the Delaunays have, and that I'm not going to go into now, because I forget. But he keeps saying about simultaneity over and over in his email that it's as new and as great as ferroconcrete, as beton armé, So apparently that, as like the tango, was like, you know, the big, the now, today, concrete. So.
Yeah. If someone could just spend 2 years in Turkey, you know, I could not really but be amazed by the presence of, you know, so many Turkish words.
In Constantinople.
Constantinople, you know, Tumb, which is granted, you know, land. Uh-huh. But, you know, you pointed out, you know, Chomwe, Galat, you know, and generally, you know, Turkish culture is, in this case, Ottoman culture, is not really a significant presence in Russian literature. And, you know, and probably the period of the two Balkan Wars, 1912-1913, you know, and then Enver Bey was one of the leaders of the Union of Progress in Turkey, Enver Bey in Great War B. So it's probably, you know, I imagine much of this is newspaper language that is making it to futurist production. But, I mean, I was, and you mentioned, you know, that Kamensky might have gone to Istanbul in 1912.
He says he has, yeah, mm-hmm. Twice. Yeah.
Yes, I mean, my first question is, you know, whether, and futurists also were not probably the people most attuned, I mean, even if they were very fond of playing with foreign words, you know, they, for the most part, did not know many foreign languages and had not really spent much time abroad. You know, they were kids from the provinces who came to the center. And it's to me interesting that, you know, it should be they who are, you know, or in this case, Kamensky, who's, you know, so keen on playing with Turkish words. So, this is not really a question as much as an invitation to ask you to think about the, you know, the role of the presence of Turkish in this booklet. And my second question, you know, which is a more general one, is of the afterlife of these graphic experiments. You know, did they come to an end with the war and the probably limitations on typographic presses during the war, and especially with the revolution?
I think both of these two comment questions, they might have the same answer. The futurists are from the provinces, but it's really not clear. The relations between the Larionov group and the Cuba futurists, they're really not, they're fraught, they're not clear. There's it's like Monday, super strong competition. Tuesday, they're, you know, doing stuff together. Wednesday, they're attacking each other in newspapers again. So it's not clear, but if you think of the two groups, both groups have a very strong connection to Georgia.
Yes.
Okay? With Zdanievich, or rather the Zdanievich brothers, in Georgia, who comes from Georgia, who brings Lidatu, who brings other people to Georgia to visit, and with Mayakovsky in the Cuba Futurist group, right? With the Burliuks also being from Ukraine. There are all these possible connections that have to do precisely with their, you know, provincialism, geographical provincialism. The other thing, as far as what happens to these experiments, the big person, Kamensky stops. it's Zdanevich, right? And Zdanevich who develops this completely original typographic, totally crazy way of doing Zaun, which might, for all I know, have pieces of Georgian in it. Since not only are they from Georgia, but apparently both Mayakovsky and Zdanevich speak the languages. At least there's evidence that they do. But Zdanevich flees after the end of the war. Zdanevich flees to Constantinople, and then goes to Paris. And the last of the plays. The plays are published starting from end of 17 or early 18 in Tbilisi, and they end with 1923 in Paris. So, and that's kind of a telling trajectory. And then in Russia of constructivism, which, you know, depends on these experiments. It's an experiment in mass production.
And Zdanevich also becomes like a fine press.
Yeah.
He does fine press books with like Picasso, and the typography is much more restrained. It's all just like Gil Sands capitals, so it's not as in like kind of inventive.
And you can find all of that stuff in Florence, and nobody's looking at it. It's because there's a guy from Prato. There was a guy from Prato. I think he's dead. Who was a friend of Zdanevich. And he compiled a huge collection and just gave it all to the Biblioteca Nazionale.
And Krishonik was still in Georgia, just publishing stuff.
Yeah.
And it would be these like little kind of like lithographed things, which would be the contemporary technology photocopying.
Yeah.
Because you'd write on transfer paper, you'd take it to the litho printer, and you would transfer it to the stone and he'd like print it for you. So it was kind of like, copying.
It's the equivalent of Kinko's, yeah.
Can you give us a translation process? Because, I mean, it seems sort of like a difficult thing to translate because it's so based in Russian language and breaking the Russian language and puns and things like that.
Well, we're working on it together because the additional constraint to the puns is that I didn't have to do exactly the same number of letters, but it had to be roughly.
Yeah, I would say, no, that's too many letters, or can you have some more letters? Or, you know, this A, it'd be great if we could keep the A.
So we've been working on this for years.
And then Matryoshka rhymes are kind of,
yeah.
They just become kind of like the Matrosi, Trosi, Osi, it's...
We had, I don't know, 20 different versions.
Yeah.
Maybe not 20, but a lot.
But I had marine sign line, but...
Yeah, what
net. Sign is like a net, but it's too much like a river.
Can you come back to this photograph with Mayakovsky and tell us who is who? Because I know Kamensky, and I know who
no,
is...
No, I don't think Kamensky is in there.
Over Mayakovsky, I think it's Kamensky.
No, I don't think so. I think it's Burliuk's brother. also Burliuk. Yeah, that's not Kamensky. I think this is Nikolai Burliuk, this is David, this is Mayakovsky, and it's Krychonek and Lipschitz.
Krychonek and?
Lipschitz. So it's like, where is this taken? This is 1913.
And then another thing I wanted to say that, because I remember that the stage sewing was made in Matushin and Elena Guro home.
Uh-huh.
So this yellow can come from her fabrics because she was collecting, I think. It might be, I'm not insisting on that, but as I remember, they were sewing this, you know? The black square, which was the background.
Wait, but she
was
died in the end of 1912, so she couldn't have worked on the Futurism.
She was not there?
I don't think she was there. No, I think he started working. I think Matushin started working on it because he needed a distraction from the death, I think. Can we Google?
Yeah, that would be
interesting. Yeah, Gouraud's death date. Yeah, because she's not. She is not. When they meet. Yeah, she dies May 6, 1913. So when they hold the meeting for Victory Over the Sun, which is in like June, July 1913, she's not in any of the photographs, which is why she's not in any of the photographs. Yeah, I mean Victory Over the Sun in that sense was kind of an attempt to cheer up Natusha. Which, although it doesn't read that way. Yeah,
I just had a general question about the deliberate crudeness of the production. And you mentioned at some point that they don't want it to look like fancy symbolist books. What are the other resonances of this deliberate crudeness? Is it supposed to suggest disposability, or is it some comment on market forces? If they had endless resources, do you think they would make fancy books? I'm just interested in the sort of deliberate roughness of it.
What do you think?
The material.
I mean, they keep, in their memoirs, they keep, I think, emphasizing how they want it to be shocking. And okay. It's a bomb thrown in the lap of the symbolists or something.
That's part of the crudeness.
Yeah, but I mean, they also didn't have very much money. So, there's talk about, I think the trap for judges, the first one they like, the game in hell, it cost 3 ruble deposit, and then Trishonek had to like scramble to find another 3 rubles to pay for it, and there's like.
But when you said 8 rubles, is that for the printing and for the wallpaper?
No, this is for the game in hell.
No, but before you said
yeah,
8 rubles.
Yeah, that would be just for the wallpaper.
Just for the wallpaper.
And the printing would have been, a fair bit more. And I know, like, Roaring Parnassus, I think they put down the deposit, they couldn't pay the rest of the printer, so it's like. They're always kind of scrambling for money for these things.
But it's also part of it. It's the look.
Yeah.
It's the Mayakovsky is disheveled. This is before he got his teeth done. They have those dandy photographs. But that's not quite how they're described in the reviews.
So it's that rather than. Any kind of emphasis on impermanence, which is what, if you were doing this
with
thing
Italians,
in other contexts,
yeah.
It would be about, I'm not going to let you commodify this, and this
No. They're for commodifying.
Okay,
this is not,
yeah.
I mean, Marinetti has this kind of programmatic emphasis on impermanence, right,
mm-hmm.
At the end of even the first manifesto. I don't recall them talking about it.
And I know at
I think I remember, Jenny, that when they talk about face painting,
uh-huh.
They contrast it to tattoos. Because the tattoos are permanent. And the great advantage, I like showing this to my students.
Okay, yeah.
So they'll know they're not being radical enough.
In the later books, they have ads for the other publications they've done, and I forget which publication it is, but one of them is like, it's like almost out of print or something, so it's 50 rubles, so they have one, most of them are like a ruble or less, and then this one is like super expensive, so that's not, it wouldn't, if they wanted things to be impermanent, you wouldn't like have the deluxe edition cost a lot.
Can you talk about the distribution? I'm assuming some people they probably gave it to get them to read it, and then did they sell the rest, or did they tell people?
Yeah, I think they had the bookstore sold them. There's an anecdote, I can't remember the details, but they talk about it selling out of this bookstore, or like looking through the window.
I imagine they sold them on readings, although
yeah.
I don't see, there's no. They don't talk about
but they certainly, In the register for publications, it lists the edition size, and so the earlier books are much smaller. They're like 300 or something, and then they get up to like 750, 1,000. So you don't make that as someone who's made books and has them in boxes and like, you know, you don't start making that many books unless you have a distribution system set up, because otherwise you just.
This is expensive though, isn't it?
It's a ruble 10. So it's, but in terms of the production costs, it probably wasn't expensive. I think they're priced to move, relatively.
But if it costs 10 rubles to get into the cabaret?
Well, I know, I was trying to figure out how much it costs to produce, and there's only data on, I can find on wages and not on like printing costs. Mm. And so like, you know, a typesetter might make 30, or like a machine minder for the press might make 30 rubles a month. So like, wow. This is like a day's wage.
So that's real money.
But it's still, you know, it's expensive to produce, so.
But you know, that might also mean that, it's funny, La Cerba in Italy is read primarily by the workers, at least according to several sources, including Gramsci. I don't think that this would be read by the workers, it would cost some people, right?
Yeah, like the Russian printing trade, most people are getting drunk.
I liked a lot the comparison with painting faces, and I'm thinking about what would be a possible answer, why did they choose wallpaper? And I'm thinking how like painting faces was a protest. I mean, face as a surface, and now we have wallpaper as a surface, and what comes to my mind is that majority of homes at that time were in wallpapers.
Yeah.
So it was a sort of protest against this like middle class lifestyle, or maybe read in that way, for example.
I mean, in Picasso it has a double function, right? There's that, the kind of the ordinariness, kind of bourgeoisness of wallpaper. But then the primary function of it in Picasso is that the traditional modes of representation, yeah, like that look like they have volume and that are non-cubist, are mass-produced, right? And they're actually printed. So I don't know if that kind of stuff would be here as well. It certainly makes sense because, you know, one page is text and cubism and the other page is, you know, the other side of the page is flowers, but it's mass produced.
Yeah, I mean, this is more thought than a question, but it's just interesting to think about this moment in comparison to other historical moments, times, places, when you have these like modes of production and reproduction that both participate in and resist certain kind modes of reproduction. Like, mm-hmm. I'm thinking of Blake, mm-hmm. for example. And when you said that they reproduce the typos, and Blake would deliberately, you know, keep and reproduce mistakes and draw attention to the crooked borders and things like that. He wanted them to be mass produced, but he didn't. But not too mass produced.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm just wondering. It would just be interesting to think about rather really different times and places when things like this happen.
Industrialization.
Exactly, and responses to that, but you're not gonna bow out, obviously, and not play the game of reproduction. Mm. You want to reproduce and disseminate, but
you want to give a sign. That,
yeah, you with sort of a little check mark, you know.
I think it's interesting thing about in the I've thought about, and it's completely different, but today production is. Of printed matter is usually first done on the computer and then output somehow, like either just a laser printer or like a, you know, you send it to the printer and they print it with an offset or something. And it restricts that, I think, interest in mistakes, because people see this, what's on the screen, as like the platonic ideal of their design, and then it's just required to produce it. but there's all sorts of interesting things that can happen in production that when it happens, it's mistaken, it's like bad, and it's hard to get away from that idea of what's on the computer screen.
And you can always go back to that pretty easily.
Yeah, and so it's like it's so pre-visualized that seems to be the final thing, and so anything along the way is a mistake and not something to be embraced. So like, you know, I work at a school and someone, you know, was printing something on both sides and they fed it on the same side and it was like this cool juxtaposition and I was like, oh, that's really cool, you should like, and then I know it's wrong, you know, so I know, like, and then Rosemary Waldrop printed the Burning Deck books for a long time, and she did a book called Camp Printing, which was based on like a mistake in printing of someone else's books, or you know, when you print, you print one and it's not in the right place, and then you send it through the press again with the type shifted over, and so that is like this kind of nice overprinting, and so the book is just inspired by this kind of overprinting. So that's another example of that kind of embracing mistake.
Any final questions?
I have a lot of questions. You're creating this digitally, and so I'm wondering, I guess both, do you think that digital, like born digital, is something that they would have appreciated, and also do you envision this both as an e-book kind of thing and a print book?
The first question is very hard to answer. The second question, I can definitely imagine it as an ebook thing. When I was deciding on this project, like one approach could have been to try to replicate the like materiality of the production, and to use like metal type and like set it, and that would have been fun, but it would have been impossible to get the same fonts, just because they're mostly like German fonts and. I don't think there's the same, you know, it would have been impossible to like get all the exact ones in the right place. And so I decided, oh, I want to, instead of replicating the process, I wanted to replicate the visual. But I've tried really hard to like think about it as material. So like every line I measure to make sure the angle of the type is right, because, you know, digital type, it's really easy. If you don't pay attention, it's just all 90 degrees. Mm-hmm. And so but when you're using metal type, things like shift, especially in their different compartments, so like the angles are different. So like every single letter, there's like, is the right angle, and the advantage with letterpress is that, you know, you can create some of the textures of the printing. You know, sometimes things are printed with not a lot of pressure, so they're weak and they're spotty, and so like you can recreate the materiality. So like a digital version might be a scan, like print on white paper and then scan it and then use that. And I think an ebook version might eventually happen, because it's frustrating. The point that I started this project was, I was like, oh, this is this really cool thing. I don't know Russian. Let me like try to do this to make it accessible. And so you know, we're doing this sort of fine press edition that's not accessible, but we also want a trade edition. But sometimes, you know, like the similar project for The Voice, when I would print is now like, you know, $500 for just like the trade version. So it's like, it's an ebook version would be a way of keeping it accessible, you know, even though it's not a material object and the materiality is not, you know, but so it's like, that would be a good thing, or print on demand, just to keep it sort of accessible, because it's really frustrating, because it's like, you know, this should cost $30, like a Prose of the Trans-Siberian. They did a second edition, but now it's sold out again, and it's like, you know, hundreds of dollars for this thing that should cost $35. So I don't want that to happen with this book.
Last questions?
Great job.
Amazing job. Yeah, great.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.